Cheers. Let's get it cracking.
I'll hit it hard.
You can't touch this. You can't touch this. You can't touch this.
You can't touch this, Pat.
Can't touch this, Brian.
You can't touch this, everyone listening to the Moote Points podcast.
That's right.
That's the lesson we're all taking.
We're back to tell you that you just can't go around touching stuff.
It should be easier, Hollywood.
It should be easier.
It should be an easy thing for you to remember.
It should be simple. And it's not just Hollywood. Rich white men. Come on, guys. You're making all
look
bad.
No, grabbing them by the know.
You know what.
Welcome back to the Moote Points
podcast.
Shouldn't
even have to tell you. You're grown men. Act like gentlemen.
The Moote Points podcast, everybody. Sorry for the long hiatus, but we are coming straight up at you out of the new Mount Vinings studio.
Yeah.
Basement studio.
Mount Vinings Media Center.
It just took a long time to get this whole thing going, man.
It did. Brian almost broke our new computer.
Oh, we almost didn't have a podcast.
He was having that thing where he's like, how come technology only does this to me? It's like it does to everybody.
Oh, my God. I just wanted to rage so hard right now.
It did.
Here's what I don't understand. Thank you for joining us again. If you want to interact with us, that sounded so dumb. If you want to interact with us right now, why don't you go over to the Twitter?
How long have you been? You're on the radio every day. How are you, Rusty?
I don't know, man.
I haven't done this in forever.
I'm tired. Tired a little bit, and I'm flustered because I almost chucked every cord that we have here straight up out the window. Holler at us on Twitter is what I was trying to say. I'm at Moote Points, and we have at Patrick Moote.
Pat Moote.
He shortened it, which is good for you. That's a good strategy.
I like to save characters, dog.
You got to save characters,
gotta
people.
Save them C's.
For those replies and those RTs with the quotes and stuff.
And those firing nastiness at our
hardcore mentions. Oh, yeah, Pat is an epic Trump troll.
Yeah.
But that's nice, though. It gives you an outlet for firing off at Trump on Twitter.
Yeah.
And I feel like if you were to meet President Trump, he would respect the game.
I would tell him straight up all the things that I say. I would show him a picture of a poop emoji, and I'd mention him in it and be like, hey, look, I found a picture of you.
Whoa.
Hot fire. I did it with a tool also.
You got him good there.
I found a picture of a tool, and I was like, hey, look, it's you.
Here's what I don't understand about technology. And what I don't understand is how can things break when you don't use them? You don't use them.
Incredible
question.
We come
down into the studio. I've been meaning for weeks to tape a podcast with my former co-host on my news talk show in Seattle, Terry Holloman. And we were going to talk about racism and the anthem protests.
All the fun stuff.
Yeah, the heavy stuff. Because, he's an African-American. He's 45 years old. He's got three great kids. He owns a business. He played professional football for a little bit. He played at the University of Washington also.
Ooh, I want to talk to him now, too. What, he've kneeled?
That's what I want to know, and I will. I'm going to talk to him this week. That'll be another episode. And we're back on track. I promise you, we're back on track. We're going to have an episode of Brewvolution coming up soon. I also, this is why I was so enraged about the technology thing. Is I bought all the attachments, the cords, the everything that we need to be able to talk to people on the phone and FaceTime and Skype, and maybe get it so that some of you guys can join us for an episode here or there, and we can hang out and. You can, chime in on something or whatever. And we set up everything. It works. I set up everything a couple weeks ago. Then Pat leaves. We'll talk about Pat, what Pat's been up to in L.A. shortly.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't. Then I come down here and plug it in, and nothing is working.
Nothing.
All the cords that have not moved since I set it up, they
don't
just decide they're not going to work. There's like a weird click that's happening.
The computer wouldn't load Adobe Audition. It's telling us that the card's no good, which is impossible because our business is thriving.
Well, okay, the card wasn't good, but it's because it was initially on my own card. But then that's my beef with Bank of America. You don't just sit. It's like all of a sudden, and now with the days of auto pay, as soon as you have a card expire, it just takes you the next 2 weeks of you having to log into every single account you've ever had. And try to and you don't know the passwords, and I gotta change every password.
Oh, you know what's the best is when they're like, oh no, you can't just have an uppercase, a lowercase, a letter, a number, and a special character. You also have to have another
something
thing.
Weird. Oh, it happened to me the other day.
I
was setting up an account for something, and I had to add, so I have my usual password, and then I had to now throw in an exclamation point.
I hate that.
On this password. So this password that I have, that I've been using for years, is now, it's evolved. Used to just be like a word and some numbers.
It used to
now
be Brian 1206, now it's Brian 126!
You have an exclamation
point. Brian 1206!
Or it's got like, I had to capitalize various letters, and then I had to add a, a different piece of punctuation there. It's got to have alternating lower cases and a dash in it. So now I've just got this evolving password that should drive me crazy.
I just want my password to be enter. That's what I have it on the computer always. Either that or PA55Word, password with fives instead of
S's. You thought you were pretty clever when you came up with that one
actually,
in high school.
Actually, our good idiot friend Haroon came up with that. Or was that Dad?
Our first password ever was A92UP4.
A92UP4, I'll never forget that.
That was to get onto our original internet at Southwoodby Wednet, wasn't it? No, it was Woodbytel.
Woodbytel. That was dial-up days, man.
It's pretty big.
All these millennials complaining about, I don't get any service in the mountains. We used to have to load pump porn one line at a time.
Just click.
Remember
click,
this sound?
Click.
Yep.
That sounded that's like what, I was doing like a racist
that's what masturbating
character.
Sounded,
I was not doing that.
That's like what masturbating sounded like in the early 90s.
You get turned on when you hear that?
Oh, I get a straight raging boner.
You know what the worst thing ever was on that slow loading JPEGs for porn was that and I don't know if you ladies will experience the same level of anticipation. Also, you're not the same level of creep as us men are.
We're
so,
creeps. We've been proving that. Lately, us guys, proven what monster creeps we are.
We will get to that.
We'll get to you guys.
Don't think we didn't forget our podcast style coming up later. Coming up later on the show. So it's slowly as the picture of the and we're talking porn back in the 90s. It was only pictures.
That was it.
And it was like click, click, and you see everything. And you get to that point where you're like, oh my god, it unveils slowly. You're like, oh yeah, boobs.
Oh god, oh boobs. God. You had to work so boobs. Hard for that.
And then as soon as it gets down to the waist area where you're about to see the genitalia,
yep,
the lower
you're about
half.
To learn you something about the female anatomy.
There's always that moment of panic for a guy where you were like, please don't have a penis.
Oh,
please.
Sure.
Because that happens,
that
man.
Happens. And you've already probably are quite aroused at the top
oh,
half.
Oh, yeah.
And
no,
you don't know what the bottom half
it
is.
It takes you like 90 seconds. So by yeah. that point in time, you're like, I'm assuming I never masturbated in high school, but I'm assuming
that's true, and that's so stupid.
I'm assuming that that it was like that, where you slowly clicked down,
yeah.
slowly.
You know what's worst is when like you'd be on the computer pretending to do work, and mom and dad would be gone or outside feeding the animals or whatever, and you'd be in there just like yes, 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 and you'd be about to get to the nipple, and then the door would open, and you'd have to cancel it and just be like, oh, 30
Dude.
Minutes of my life.
So you know what's
gone.
Funny? Now you totally outed yourself right now as to who was the one who looked at the porn on mom's computer or the family computer when we were in high school.
That was me.
And all a bunch of pop-ups came flying up.
Yeah.
So it's a true.
But there was three of us, and all of us were going to say it wasn't us. So I knew it was fair game.
Yeah, but for real, it wasn't
Fake
me because
news,
I
mom,
wouldn't even
wasn't
know
me.
Why you were looking at naked women on the internet because I didn't understand. I didn't masturbate till I was 19.
It's ridiculous.
I hate the word masturbate, but I also trying to keep it classy.
Yeah.
So
jerk off is no classy.
I was sitting in the living room. My mom was out on the family computer, and all of a sudden, and this is back in the day when like pop-ups first started. Remember when pop-ups first started?
Yeah,
and
they were aggressive. They'd shut it down.
Well, you'd have like 60 in a row, or like all of a sudden you'd get a pop-up bomb, or be like,
oh,
bing,
yeah.
bing, 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 all over
oh,
the screen.
We made a website once where we tricked people to do that. They'd be like, hey, want to see a picture of this girl's boobs? And then like a million pop-ups would just crush your computer.
So she literally was so angry. She was so angry at the she immediately was like, oh my god, we need to get a new computer. Who did this? I'm like, mom, I'm defending everybody. I'm like, right. Mom, listen, I don't think it was any of us. There's this new thing now where if you click an email sometimes, if you click like the wrong thing on an email, it will like load up a bunch of weird stuff on your computer, and it probably was just an accident, and there's like spam and stuff. But she was so mortified at our computer.
In the background, I was like, yeah, mom.
Totally.
Duh.
Do you know how computers work?
Yeah.
So my mom was so mortified that it wasn't like she let my dad's office tech guy work on the computer. She literally decided we needed a new computer because she treated it like it was a victim. Like the computer had seen something that she'd seen.
Yeah.
And she's like, neither one of us can ever unsee this. Like she was embarrassed to be in front of the computer again. So we had to go get a brand new computer. And then that computer, that dirty HP, went like out into like we had like this side house that just a bunch of kids hung out and had a pool table.
It was like one of those
stuff.
Kids back in like the 40s, the girls at like a colloquial Catholic school who got like knocked up and then they'd be sent away because they were ashamed.
Scarlet letter.
Shame, shame.
Had to wear the letter P.
We've just been treating women like crap forever. On behalf of men everywhere, we're sorry. What the fuck is wrong with us?
So anyways, the technology, my technology woes are continuing. I have now,
that's what you get,
Bank of America decided they're just going to send me a new card. Hey man, my card wasn't broken. My card was just fine. And then they're like, no, we're going to send you a new one. But then that shuts down all of your auto pays, which is nice because I just found out that I am still paying for a gym that I thought I canceled. So that's convenient that they're like, hey, Brian, you haven't paid your gym membership. I'm like, yeah, because I canceled it 3 months ago, you jerks.
Planet Fitness isn't even around anymore.
No, leave me. Yeah, right. How can you keep charging me when you don't exist? So we almost didn't make this happen today.
We were close
with the technology.
And honestly, as much as I'd love to just back Brian up and be like, we're going to start putting one out every week, I'm going back to LA in like 3 hours.
He is going back to LA in like 3 hours.
But I'll be back.
Well, okay, we're going to get into that right now. Why were you in L.A.?
I was back in L.A. because this is the very busy commercial acting season for me. Got the holidays coming up, got football and basketball.
Oh, that's right.
A lot of advertising money, so this is when they shoot a lot of commercials, so went back. I've been busy, though. I will find out today whether or not I booked a Capital One commercial with Jennifer Garner. And I came out here to Atlanta for 36 hours because I thought that I booked a part in a Kevin Hart movie. Turns out, Brian...
You did not book the part in the Kevin
Hart movie. I did not book the part in the Kevin Hart movie.
But it's really promising that the casting director would have you come out.
Yeah, they love me. They love me. Well, and you, speaking of commercials and people who might be... So I've had this big gripe that a lot of people who've listened to the podcast have heard me bitch about this before, but there's too many celebrities doing commercial.
You don't like the spokesman type.
No, and just like, even if it's not spokesman, it's like, you're just... Like, sometimes it's not. It's just like, hey, I'm Rob Lowe, and I sign... my feet get tired when I sign autographs. Where's Skechers? They're more comfortable. Like, why is that relatable? That's a real thing! Rob Lowe explaining why Skechers are so great to walk around in when you're signing autographs. It's like, oh yeah, that's what everybody's problem is all day long, is my feet hurt from signing autographs. Thanks, Rob Lowe. Anybody could have done that commercial, and it's a shit commercial to begin.
Who's the one that you hate the most right now?
Thomas Middleditch. Only because he's beat me out for stuff.
Well, yeah, you guys are very much in the same genre of commercially.
Okay, I thought you were going to say, like, the same genre of person. It's like, no, he's a dork. And I'm
cool. No, but you would cat... I mean, unfortunately, what's funny about that, in my world, like... In my world, at 6'3". I'm, like, an oversized giant. So,
yeah,
I don't... I can't go in for parts that are... Like, Thomas Middleditch is, like... I am three Thomas Middleditches.
It's true.
And you're like a Thomas Middleditch and a half. And that half is a little bit too much for a lot of Hollywood. That's what drives me crazy. If we just decided to let people in Hollywood be bigger, like to be reflect the size of actual people, we could all get acting jobs. But instead, we make Tom Cruise look like he's not 5'1".
Oh, he's a baby. He's such a tiny baby.
You know who's smaller than I thought they were? The Rock. The Rock is not that big.
Rock
is a strong... No, but The Rock looks huge.
But he's like still 6...
6'2", 6'3"? He's
yeah,
in my size.
6'3".
The Rock is my height.
Yeah, but also an extra 100 pounds of muscle.
He's shredded. I'm not saying he's not shredded. I'm saying they make him look like Hercules because they put him next to 5 foot
baby
one Kevin Hart, and they're like, wow, look how big he is. Well, Kevin Hart is tiny.
Kevin Hart is teeny tiny. He's very, very tiny. So either way... I have been in L.A. Trying to be moderately famous in the commercial acting world. And it's going well, but they don't... So you go to an audition, then they call you for a callback. You go to the callback, and then if you do all the callback, they put you on a veil, which means they basically just call you and tell you, guess what? You're really, really close to booking this. We just want to make sure that you're still available.
Yeah, if we don't book you...
Yeah, it'd be like an ex calling you, being like, hey, look, I might start dating somebody else, but I just want to see if you're single or not, because if I decide I don't like them, I might date you.
That's not a bad idea, though, putting you on a veil.
Putting you on a veil, yeah. Listen, I'm going...
I'm thinking about going a different direction, if things get sad during the holidays, I'm going to need a shoulder to cry on.
You know what's even crazier is that they don't even call you to tell you that they're not gonna book you. Like, the day just passes. Like, I thought I was supposed to be shooting yesterday, and then the day passed, and I was like, well... I guess
apparently I'm not
in the movie.
That is, I mean,
it's
about
bogus.
Talk about ghosting and people like not getting closure. Man, you don't know what that feels like really until you go in for an audition. You do well. You have like two or three of them. You get a call back or whatever, which rarely happens for me, but it has happened in the past. And then you never hear about the job. You hear nothing. And then you're like, hey, I wonder what happened with that. And then you see it on TV. You're like, oh, that.
And they cast someone who looks exactly like you. You know what I'm also worried about? Because this has happened. the button that I had in the scene for the Kevin Hart movie was top-notch hilarious. Like, it was really, really funny. And I hope that they don't use it. Because that's happened in commercials before where I've, like, gone in and I've said something really funny at the end of the scene that isn't scripted, didn't get the part, got really close. Then I see it on TV and the guy on the thing's like, "Oh, really, buddy?" And I'm like, "That's me! I did that, you..."
Oh, speaking of that, man, I want to pull up a
fire right now. I'm so upset. No, I'm not really, actually.
Okay.
I don't even care.
We're going to close out this podcast with something. I'm going to play something for you from a show called Big Mouth. Have you seen the show Big Mouth on Netflix? It's a cartoon written by a bunch of comics and, like, I think Jordan Peele and Nick Kroll are kind of the big names behind it, John Mulaney. Now, there is a scene in that, and we're going to play it at the end because I want to get your honest reaction because you know I have a joke about... a guy pushing a girl's head down to get her to blow him, right?
Sure.
You've heard that joke.
Yeah, no, it's a classy stuff.
Really classy.
Yeah.
And I like to try to keep it as clean as possible on the pod. I know I say that, and then people are like, "You guys should swear more in the podcast." I'm like,
"Fuck yeah!"
All right. So I'm gonna pull it up on Netflix, and I'm gonna play it for you. At the end of this podcast, because we're gonna get into in a few minutes here talking about. The creepiness of Hollywood,
yeah.
And Pat's got a great story about it. I've got a couple too, but I want you to finish out what you're talking about LA, but then I'm going to play for you the scene from Big Mouth, and I want you to tell me straight up if you think one of these stand-up comedians, because there are a lot of young ones who wrote the episodes, ripped this off for me seeing me do a show, because I'm not even kidding you. They literally took my entire bit, tags and all.
When I was doing improv, like, years ago, I think Seth MacFarlane got famous off of me. I think he was sitting in the crowd or one of his writers because a bunch of them went to Acme Comedy Theater. I know it. And there was stuff that came out of there where my phone, like, on a new episode of Family Guy, all of a sudden my phone would go off, like, 9 times. And everybody in my improv group would be like, "Did you just say they just said, what was it, side boob?" I had been saying titty side forever. Forever.
Titty
it's
side.
It's better, yes.
Titty side.
The titty side. Because
I mean, side boob's just more of an observation that became a thing. You know what I mean?
Observed it first, and I made it a thing first.
Titty side, you're really killing my thing. But that is a thing. That's honestly, legitimately a thing that happens rampantly in Hollywood, is people just ripping off comics jokes and using them in sketch form,
yeah.
Or for SNL, or for Mad TV, or for the Amy Schumer show. And that happened with Amy's show a bunch. And people blasted Amy for it, and I was like, "Listen, I know Amy very well, and she wouldn't steal jokes, but... she doesn't have the time to write these sketches. If you think she's writing these sketches, you're way wrong. I mean,
sure.
She's flying on private jets all over the world and shooting movies
and
stuff.
Well, and has, like, a team of writers that she then, like,
exactly.
You know, passes off.
A lot of stand-up comics who sit at these crappy shows that everyone does, and they sit there in the back, and then they're like, "Oh, that's a funny idea." And then they I feel like they don't think it's stealing if they just make it a sketch versus stand-up or write it into a script.
Well, and sometimes you don't even realize it, maybe. Like, you know, you hear it, and then, like, a month later, you're like, "I have a funny idea that came from my own brain." And it's like, no, that wasn't it. That you didn't come from your own brain.
No, but also, they have a ton of pressure to try
either
to,
way,
to try
the
to
point
funny.
Of the story is these people are jerking me around. Not really. I am happy to be doing what I'm doing, and I came out here because I wanted to be available just in case I got the part.
It would have been pretty cool.
It would have been pretty cool. And you know what's funny is I started this week like, man, I'm crushing it. I'm going to avail for 2 things. I could book both of these. I'm now at the point where I'm like, I think I book none. I think
hey,
I book
man, as long as you're in the mix.
The Capital One commercial, all I do is shush Jennifer Garner. It can't be that. How many people?
That's it, but you're a good shusher.
I know. I should have booked it by now. They should have told me.
All right, Pat. Do you know why I'm playing this song?
Yeah, because of all the creepy people in Hollywood.
Yeah, buddy.
Because of all the creepy people in Hollywood. And you know what? I'm glad
one
you're
by
getting,
one they start
glad
falling.
You're getting called out because I have seen a lot of people do a lot of creepy things in my time in Hollywood, and for some reason it's like people tolerate it. Like, and it's not like I've never seen anything so terrible, but yeah, you are. Weinstein. Affleck, creep.
Spacey.
Super creep.
Dustin Hoffman.
Creep?
Yeah, that just came out. I know, man.
Damn it.
It's going to change how you look at all those movies again. But Dustin Hoffman's, and I don't want to say
except for The Graduate, because he was taken advantage of in that one.
I don't want to say.
Mrs. Robinson, you dirty old.
I don't want to say, but Dustin Hoffman. I mean, I will say it, though, because at this point, It's like Dustin Hoffman got accused by a seven. I don't remember the woman's name, but she was 17 on the set of Death of a Salesman or something, and he was groping her and being a creep. And I don't know how old he was.
How do you grope? Like,
what is groping?
What is groping?
How do you grope?
You just start grabbing people, like in
like
the,
honk honk.
I know. Like, what is the? What?
I've never groped anyone in my life.
Hey, let me just.
I wouldn't even know how to To start that, what's your grope entry?
I don't know. Great butt. Let me grope it.
Groping.
I don't understand that. Like, is it like in a hug maybe? Like, and you're like just grabbing and touching too much and like
grabbing a handful of butt.
I don't know why you would do that. Like, what happened to us, guys? Guys, what happened to us? When did we just decide? I mean, and granted, it probably used to be a lot worse, and so we've gotten better since like the dark ages. But give me a break. It's 2017 and we're groping?
I mean, I think that...
Get fired up.
It's generational in the sense that, you know, like, hey, toots, and they, people slap your ass like, hey, right, you know, there you go, pat, pat on the butt. It's like...
Well, listen, Mad Men, it's over. Right. Game's over. We can't smoke inside either. And whiskey during the day is not... is alcoholism.
And I think that now it's become, in the workplace especially, it's become kind of like this, hey, joke, whoops, grabbed your butt. Or like, I don't know. I don't know how it even happens.
I know. Now, I've talked to friends like, I mean, even, you know, years ago, Dad had clients and stuff. And we talk, and people that I've grown up with that I've known in Hollywood, like, telling me things where they're like, yeah, I just hate my boss. It's like, why? Because, you know, like, every time I, like, go to bend over something, he just, like, takes, like, his hand and, like, pulls my shirt down so he can, like, see down my shirt. And it's like, he does what?
Yeah, that's insane.
That's your, and your boss? Like, that's not like, cool.
Guy knows that's, like, super illegal, right?
That's not... That would be, like... I mean, and I can't imagine if... Like, guys, put yourself in their position. I know most guys are going to be like, oh, that'd be sweet, man. But imagine it's someone you don't want to be touching your genitals. And they walk up to you and they're like, hey, buddy, I like your khakis. And they just reach over and grab your balls. Like, why? That would make me very uncomfortable.
No, it's insane. And I remember when we were working, my father was an attorney that he worked in sexual harassment claims and stuff like that. And he had a few of them. That is Bosworth, by the way, if you just heard him on the podcast. He spends 90% of his life sleeping until we decide to fire up microphones. And then he decides to come out of his hibernation and bug the ever-living crap out of
me. And then he just has stuff to do.
Like, did he not hear my technology problems earlier, Bosworth?
Nah, Bos.
One thing, so my dad represented a bunch of waitresses. And this one... manager. Well, one, he tried to sleep with all the servers and stuff, which is, I mean, you're wildly asking to be fired, even if it's consensual and it's like you guys are dating or whatever. That's just inappropriate. But what he would do is girls would be wearing skirts at this restaurant, and he would, when they were like leaning over or something, he would take his hand, put it up between their legs, like under their skirt, and go credit card. And, like, running a credit card with his hand. It's just so disgusting.
Oh, boy.
And some of the girls, like, in the filings, like, didn't wear underwear. And he's, like, pretty much just touching their vagina, like, wide open.
And here's a newsflash. Dude, not cool.
Yeah, let him have it. Controversial point.
Yeah, not cool, guys. Not fucking cool.
I mean, I've had people, like, at picture, like, meet-and-greet things for comedy or radio. Like, I've had women, like, do kind of inappropriate things. But it's also – I know they're kidding around, and I don't really have – I have a pretty thick skin. But I remember we were in Woodstock playing Mad Life Studios, and this drunk lady who – one came up to me going like, I don't even know who you are. My friends listen to you. Oh, I'm like, great. God, can we take a picture? I'm like,
this woman
why?
Sucked.
Okay, you lady. But she kept making it a point to be like, I don't know who you are. I've never heard of you. I'm like, you said that like 5 times. And that's fine. Not everyone needs to listen to the radio show or know who I am. But I don't need you to keep saying that over and over again. It's getting a little bit annoying. In the middle of a picture, she dropped down and looked like she was blowing me. As the picture, and I was like, whoa, okay, if you want that photo, I mean, you're the one who looks terrible in that.
Yeah, but still, it's a violation of, like, you know, you don't even want that picture out there.
No,
like, you know,
picture's terrible.
Yeah, and she was really weird. She was really touchy and, like, kept trying to, like, drag me over to this table to sit with her and her friends, and I was just like, I don't know, like, stop, lady, like, what is your deal? And I've had, like, people be aggressive to the point where I was like, okay, enough. And that's both men and women. you know, and the guys are usually worse about it. Like, and I mean, and I have been in Hollywood, and I don't necessarily want to name a bunch of names, but I will say that the Kevin Spacey thing came as no surprise to me. I've talked to a bunch of people who had worked with him, all dudes, and all of them were like, this guy is a huge creep.
The Kevin Spacey stuff is the first time, and I'm not trying to say this like the other stuff didn't impact me as much, but I don't know Harvey Weinstein. You know, I know he's made a lot of movies that I loved, you know, whatever, he's been the financial backer, but he's not on camera, right?
Right.
You know, I don't, like Bill Cosby, I've never met him. I don't really, I respect like his comedy legend way
his
before.
Was different too, because it was like, it wasn't just, that was like an actual, like he was drugging people.
Yeah, and
like,
he's a serial
so
rapist.
That, yeah, that's a, like that serial rape is worse than being like sexually assaulting people, like a habitual sex,
well,
but not a lot worse.
It's,
like
it's all awful and
it's
terrible.
Really bad. Poor.
You
want to
be careful
behavior.
About belittling yeah. the legality
let's,
of things.
Let's rank things. Let's rank the terrible things that men do to women from worst
yeah.
to least bad.
No. So
God, Jesus.
The thing with, now I'll never listen to Cosby again. Clearly. But I was never a big Cosby fan either. I think the thing that's killing me now with this Kevin Spacey thing is like, man, I was a Kevin Spacey fan. Like, yeah. I loved House of Cards, man, and I loved Unusual Suspects, and I loved
that
every
show,
character he
sure.
was in.
That show collapsed like a House of Cards.
Oh, it's done.
Dunzo.
Well, we talked about this the other day when we were in the kitchen, and I said, well, Netflix clearly pulled the plug because they know something that we don't. Like, they know more. This is just an avalanche.
Oh, I mean, I guarantee you in the next couple weeks, a bunch of people are going to come out saying things. Because I know at least three people that I've known long enough to know that they're not messing around when they were either saying, I've seen the behavior or I've experienced it firsthand. Like, very, very forward, aggressive, creepy, male, whatever. Like, I don't get it. And like, you know, it seems weird, and you know, I think a lot of people are like, oh well, if someone's treating you like that, you know, you should just say no or walk out of the situation. Or but in the entertainment industry, there's so few opportunities,
right.
And when people have some sort of power over you, they have a lot of power over you, and it's very, very hard. And when they're manipulators and when they're mean, they're gonna hold those things over your head. And I've felt in those situations where I was like, this is someone who could really help my career. But I mean, should we get into that story?
Should we
name names?
Let's get into that story in a second. I want to expand on that point. It's the power brokers is what
yeah.
it is. And that, I think, is what is extra creepy about it. And even Cosby, it was creepy with Cosby. But all of these men are using their power and wielding it over people who they know need the power.
Yeah.
And they are making them do things they don't want to do because they're going to give them a piece of something. It's classic quid pro quo sexual harassment, which is this for that, is what quid pro quo
sure.
means. So what I hate about it, and I know it's not just men either, because I have some stories about women doing this too in,
sure.
in Hollywood. But it's that...
It's mostly men.
Well, mostly men because it's an industry dominated at the
and
top
it's
by
been,
men.
And they've been getting away with it forever.
Well, that's because no one wants to bury their name.
No.
So, like, if you come out early, like, people... I got an email the other day from a guy who was like, well, it's not, you know, I know it's happening, man, but we're trying to act like none of these actresses ever got a leg up from sleeping
gross.
With Harvey Weinstein. I'm like, yeah,
gross
man, okay,
guy.
Listen.
You're a gross person.
I'm sure they did. Here's the difference. The ones that are coming forward did not want
no.
to do anything like that.
No.
Yes, I am sure... There are a few women out there, as there are probably a few men who played the game too.
If Steven Spielberg walked in here right now and was like, hey, Pat, like I would probably willingly do some stuff that I would regret, but I would do it.
Well, but even then, you can regret it. So my point is this. The difference is that Harvey Weinstein said, hey, if you do this, I'll do this for you. If you don't do this, I will ruin your name. And if you tell anybody, I will bury you.
Yeah.
Now, the difference is that I know that, and I know some of my friends in LA have done this, have literally hooked up with casting directors and casting agents just because they're like, this gives me a better shot. Or, you know what, I flirt with them or whatever. Like,
sure.
All you have to do is go to the Improv Comedy Club bar on any random night of the week, and you see people, both men and women, in the business, completely outkicking their coverage, talking to people who are way out of their league. That's
yeah.
how you know. It's like,
I mean,
it's like you think this Hollywood 10 is gonna be hanging out with this like fat, oversized 6 who's
yeah.
not even trying.
I mean, I've gone out to dinner with one, he was like a producer, casting manager.
You were victimized.
Whatever. No, I wasn't.
Kidding.
He was really sweet. He just liked taking out like. You know, he would take out, like, me, a couple of girls that I knew, and then another one of my buddies. And both of us knew that, like, he was, you know, potentially interested in us because, you know, we're hot. We're hot dudes, of course. How could he not be? Man. Come on.
You're wiry
and
strong.
And he would kind of flip. Thank you, Brian. He would
my brother's amazingly strong. Side note. Crazy. He doesn't look strong. He looks like skinny and like he's
145 pounds right over my head.
No, he's like strong in every direction. Like I'm strong in like a bench press capacity or like shoulders. Patrick is strong like a swimmer. Like every 360 degrees of his shoulder is the same amount of strength the entire time.
I got all the muscles.
It's enraging because when you try to wrestle him, he's so far out of my weight class, lower.
Wiry.
That I should be able to dominate him, and for some reason, strangely, he can keep up. Not like we... I don't want you guys to think that we go wrestling around all the time.
Yeah, we're just wrestling.
That's what we do. And now we have a three-story
house
I'm actually about to
come clean with some truth about Brian, you guys.
So
he wrestles me.
No, but that is an honest thing, though. There are a lot... Hollywood is a business built on dinners. And it's like that for any business,
and
I'm convinced.
It's just...
Politics.
It's when people... There is a line. There's a line between, like... flirting and like trying to, because part of what you're trying to do as a performer is charm people,
right?
You know, like, and this is, I've had girlfriends who had problems with this where they were like, well, you just want everybody to want to sleep with you. It's like, yeah, men, women, everybody, dogs,
yeah,
cats, that's the thing. That's what I'm selling. What I'm selling is, you know, either you want to sleep with me or you want to be with me or you want to hang out with me,
right?
But you're selling your charisma.
That's the
key. So it's that you have to flirt. Like there has to be a little bit of that. You're trying to get them to feel the same way you want every. It's really narcissistic now that it's coming out of my mouth. But it's true.
Well, the thing about it is that to be the best at anything, you have to have a level of, I don't want to say narcissism, but confidence. But confidence and narcissism can really, they can walk hand in hand if you don't check one versus the other.
Sure.
But you've got to, in show business, you've got a lot of people who expose themselves on a probably not the right word. They put themselves.
I mean, it seems appropriate.
You have people that are exposing themselves too. But
yeah, you do. You do. They are being exposed.
No, you have people who put themselves out there, you know, creatively, and they have to 100% believe that they're the best, that they do the best, that they can book this, that they got this job.
Right.
And if they just keep hanging in there, they're gonna make
I'll
it.
I'll tell you what, and I think that, you know, I might, like, a girl might look at me and be like, well, he's like about a 7 maybe, and then if I'm having a confident day and I'm being charismatic, by the end of the day they might be like, oh, he's like an 8 now because he's fun. But I think that works a lot with people, is like, you know, like just that confidence, that believing in yourself, but also just that the confidence to kind of walk into a room and be like, I'm gonna charm this whole room, I'm gonna make this whole room like me, you know. And it's kind of the curse, but it's also the blessing. But it also doesn't mean that you want people to be grabbing you where you don't want to be grabbed, or that you want to sleep with everybody, or that.
And that's the most troubling part about all of this, is that you see the people in the position of power who are creepy, who are sexual predators, who are just narcissistic sociopaths, who they use their position and hold it over someone's head and are like, listen, I know this business. If you want to get to the next level, this is what you got to do. And you got these people who, and this is why I hate it, and it hits close to home for the entertainment stuff, is that, yeah, man, you got people sleeping on air mattresses 4 deep in a 2-bedroom apartment. You don't think that one of those people is like, I want to sleep with Harvey Weinstein, but I need out of this apartment.
Anything.
And I have been struggling for years living on nothing. You know, like, a lot of people don't understand the level of kicks in the nuts that you have to take to be in show business.
Kicked. This week is just a big kick in the nuts for me. I'm flying all over the country not booking shit.
Yeah, you booked this podcast.
I booked
this episode of the podcast.
That's right. We have champagne.
This happened to Patrick.
Yes.
This story creeps me out to a level that is... It just creeps me out because, one, you're my brother, and two, it's like I've met this dude. I thought he was creepy to begin with, and I think he did 100% exactly... I think his whole thing was just to try to sexually assault you, basically.
So he wanted it. Yeah, he did. He wanted it. Sorry, I was pouring myself a glass of champagne. I'd actually forgot about this completely until you brought it up right before we did the podcast, where you're like, remember with... And all, you know what? I'm going to name names because we're naming names. Barry Sobel. He's a comedian. And you know, I thought he was a pretty good friend of mine, and he's close with a lot of my other friends who might take offense to me even bringing this up here. But
who cares, dude?
But
the guy,
the
guy's a legendary creep, and he tried to victimize
you. And it worked, and I saw it work with other people. I saw him do that with other people. And granted, they probably might be like, oh, no, it's whatever. It's not a big deal. But there was times where I know he crossed lines that were very, very much... which were very much uncool. And like, So what happened is I meet this guy. Everybody, he's, you know, been around for a long time.
He's a comedy legend, okay? Yeah. And he was big in the 80s and 90s, and he's kind of got that Andy Dick vibe to him.
Yeah.
Where Andy Dick is like, he's kind of, well, he just got booted off a Netflix project.
Yeah.
A movie, because he's been running around grabbing people and licking their face and stuff like a weirdo. But Andy Dick is a weirdo. He's insane. If you lived in LA, you have an Andy Dick story. You have a Pauly Shore story. You have all these weird.
Steve-O. You got a Steve-O story.
Yeah, you just got those stories from those guys that are just always out and about. So he made it big as a comedian in the 80s and 90s, like doing Carson and doing all this stuff for being kind of eccentric and out there. Then he kind of fell off the map because that kind of comedy became unpopular. And when we were living in L.A., this is like early on. I lived in L.A. I was in grad school.
Yeah, I was living in Venice Beach, which is kind of where his like stomping grounds were. And he has a bit of a reputation around there. But I remember we started talking. He started offering a lot of things. I know Tom Hanks, and I know this person. I know the casting people for everywhere.
Which he does know those people.
Yeah, but those people are also kind of like, Barry.
I mean, he's like the guy's like, Barry.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, and I believe that, you know, that part of him, his heart was in the right place at times. It felt like that. But also, like, you know, he started telling me about how much he could help me, and he had this project he wanted me in, and it's all about, like, you know, a dude struggling, but I'm perfect for it, and I'm so talented, and kind of pumping up my ego, and I'm like, yeah, great, I love this, I love hearing this, I'm new here, I don't know what's going on, I know this guy who's all connected. I get the script, and it's almost a porno of me doing a million homosexual
acts.
Well,
he booked you for the thing, not telling you.
Not telling me that.
Like,
that
conveniently
particular.
Glossing over the fact that you were going to have been on a bunch of homosexual scenes.
It was a rewrite.
That's right. You booked it.
He
saw
gave
the
it
original
to me.
Script.
I liked it. I was like, this is great. We're actually doing it. Then he's like, I did some rewrites a few days or a week before we're going to shoot, and I read it, and I'm literally like naked making out with guys like the whole time. Which, granted, if it were a legit project, I don't have like the homophobic side of me where it's like, if I got booked on something and they were like, hey, you have to, as an example, make out with Tom Hardy in this scene, like, I'd make out with Tom
conveniently
Hardy.
Conveniently, your man crush.
Conveniently, I'm making out with my
man
crush.
Yeah, if I had to make out with DiCaprio.
If it was somebody.
But it's acting. See,
but it's acting.
It's not like an attraction
and
thing.
It doesn't matter to me. It wouldn't make me feel like a homosexual. It wouldn't make me feel. But when it's this guy who's objective is very obviously to put me in situations that will make me uncomfortable and him aroused based on the fact that he thought that I was desperate enough to actually go for this. It made me sad. It was like a bummer. And I was like, no.
Oh, dude, I remember you were bummed out because
I was really bummed out.
You were excited about the fact, like, I remember you telling me about this.
And I thought we were friends. Like, I was like, I got a famous buddy. Like,
I remember you telling me stories about Barry Sobel, and I looked him up, and I was living in Boston, and Boston has, like, his name in Boston means something because it's like people would say, oh, Barry Sobel, he spent some time out here back in the 80s because Boston was a comedy mecca. And I was like, oh, man. And I kind of had this, like, brotherhood type mentality for any comedian who spent time in Boston because, man, I played those same rooms. They're still there. The still crowds are still surly on a Thursday night, you know, wildly Irish.
Yeah. Well,
you know? And so I remember hearing that, and then I remember you booked the thing and you went in for the table read with him,
mm-hmm.
and you were like, you called me, you're like mortified. You're like, dude, I had to like just tell him, like, what the hell are you doing?
And what rewrite was this? Like, oh my God, this is not like a little rewrite. This is a fairly big thing, and it's like you and me in your apartment reading this script together, and I was just like, dude, come on, man. Like, are you serious? Like, does this actually work? And here's the thing. It does.
It does work.
It does work.
It does work because you could have
every time I see him now, he's got some little band of, like, kids who are young and young dudes who are fresh in the industry who want to make films, who want to help people out, and he's towing them around, telling them how much he can help them out and all these things. And I've seen it before where there have been nights where, like, he's getting this dude way messed up, and I'm like, he's trying to convince him to stay, and the dude's like, I don't know. And I'm like, I'm out, dude. Like, I'm leaving. Yeah. Like, you should roll with, and then dude stays night, and you hear from other people that it got weird.
And I feel bad. I feel bad for you that happened because I feel like it set you back a little bit in terms of your trust for people out there. And rightfully so, you got to have your guard up.
Fucking asshole, man.
You got to have your guard up.
I've been in LA way too long. I hate everything.
And the thing is now is that this is just going to be one after another. One after another of these old power brokers going down for being absolute creeps.
And
good. And I hope I hope people remember that name, Barry Sobel, and I hope people come out. If I mean, I really do truly hope that that was an isolated incident, and that maybe he just misunderstood the whole situation. And I don't believe any of what I'm saying right now, but I'm saying I hope to God that nothing ever happens and one ever cares. And but I have a feeling, not with him, but you've got other famous comedians, really famous comedians with humongous rumors about them in Hollywood, about them pleasuring themselves in front of like opening acts, and I'm talking like stadium drawing comedians. Mm-hmm. I'm like hesitant, and here's okay. I'm feeling what a lot of women feel when they don't come forward. I've been hearing a story wildly for years about one specific comic who plays stadiums. And his set is really self-deprecating, and he's like he's always talking about like masturbating and stuff. And there was a woman, Jen. Shoot, her last name's escaping me. Jen. It's gonna kill me. Anyways, I'll think of it eventually. But she told a story on a podcast about how she was opening for him in Australia, and he literally kept calling her room while he was masturbating and doing all this weird stuff. And she did she dropped his name on a podcast, which is why I'm a little hesitant to do it, because also it's a rumor, I guess. But she got dropped by an agency. She got threatened by a production company, by 3Arts came after her and stuff. So it's very serious. And the problem is that you have these companies, like the Weinstein Company was paying women off.
Yeah.
It's always going to follow the money, which makes me crazy. So as soon as these... As soon as the story gets too big and Netflix starts, you know why Netflix yanked that whole thing, yanked that whole production House of Cards, is because they're gonna lose money on corporate sponsorship. Production company is gonna lose money. Even if the production is good, they're gonna lose a bunch of money on all of it. So it's one of those situations where it's always gonna follow the money, and these companies need to stop hiding these people. If you got a guy who's a creep, like I hate the whole thing like Kevin Spacey's doing now. He's going to go get help and be reevaluated. Really, now is when you want to go get help?
Well,
you tried to sexually assault a 14-year-old when you were 26. That was 30 years ago.
Yeah.
So now you're going to just say for 30 years you didn't know you had a problem? Man, get out of here.
Like, and to clarify, like I'm not trying to throw anybody, the last thing I'd ever try and do is throw anybody under the bus, unless it is one of those things.
It's not throwing anyone under the bus.
Well,
the bus should have been coming for you a long time ago.
Exactly.
If you're doing this
stuff. And you know, the hope is that even if you know some of these people and you disagree with the behavior, the hope is that they will go and get help, that they will go and seek help. But the thing is that there's been this culture of like not only making it okay and justifying it, but also hiding it. Like you're saying, like the money is hiding it because it's not good for them. But also, like, there's just a culture of like, oh, maybe I had too many drinks, or yeah, I get like that sometimes when I'm a little, you know, messed up. Like, but it's not the culture of it has to stop, and the only way to do it is to make people held accountable. Like, you know, Harvey Weinstein, sure as shit, I bet you he's gonna think twice before he does anything creepy again, because
I mean, hopefully he goes to jail.
I mean,
he's a sexual predator.
Yeah.
I mean I think the depressing part is that you, I'm feeling right now exactly what, because I'm afraid to name one huge comedian, because I know that just the random fact that someone listens to this and tweets at him or tweets at his company at CAA or ICM or Gersh or somebody, and then all of a sudden they're like, take this down or whatever. And, you know, it wasn't my story to tell. I mean, she told it the first time, and she took a beating for it from the business. So this is just the tip of the iceberg. And to that I say, I'm sorry to everyone who's been victimized, but also I say, good, man, it's about time.
Yeah, start calling these people out. I mean, and you know, I might, there, you know, there may be a possibility that I have a friend who's like, hey, somebody listened to the podcast and said that you're talking shit. I'm gonna be like, well, I mean, we all knew this. We're all guilty for not saying anything about it.
You're not talking shit.
No.
You're telling a story of something that happened to you, and I think it's important.
Yeah. Yeah, it is.
You like Fergie?
Yeah. Sure, yeah, I like Fergie.
She was at Q100's Qtopia the night, and she,
I'd love to hear the interview.
Ah, the audio engineers blew it. We have no interview. All right, before we get out of here, I want to play for you the scene from Big Mouth. that is easily a joke.
This is our blasting comedians podcast.
Man, this became really Hollywood ranty. Not another.
You know
bitter,
what?
Right?
I don't care, man. I'm out here flying around not booking anything, so I got a little rant that in me that I need to get out. And honestly, like, a lot of this bad behavior that's going on right now that's getting called out, a lot of it's happening in Hollywood. I mean, you look at Trump, like, yeah, okay, Trump's president. That's politics. It happens. Honestly, I know it happens a ton in politics, too. Trump is the one who's managed to do it in both sides of the spectrum. He's just jumping back and forth, grabbing whatever he wants.
I really don't think at this point he's doing anything in politics. He's probably living the cleanest life he's ever lived.
Yeah, because
in terms of, like, he can't, like, he doesn't.
I mean, they make him put on oven mitts whenever he gets off and plays. Like, stop grabbing stuff.
He wields the power. Don't get on your anti-Trump ramp. That's what your Twitter's for. Okay, Pat, here's the scene from Big Mouth. It's called a head push. Ready?
Oh. Okay.
Oh, you're making out with somebody.
Kissing someone.
You're kissing.
Oh, Barack Obama.
And you're pushing someone's...
Coach Steve eating a sandwich.
You're praying?
You're praying to Mecca. You're a Muslim.
Barack Hussein Obama.
Someone kissing another person.
Oh, is it Party Wolf?
Daniel. You're doing Daniel.
Wait, what? That's not me.
Actually, that is so you.
How is that Daniel?
He's a head pusher.
He's a head pusher.
He did a head push.
Head push? What is a head push?
It's when a man pushes a woman's head to try to get a blowjob.
Wait, that's a move?
Not a fan of the head push.
All my life I've been waiting for them to go down there. I didn't know you could do a push.
You can't push.
No push. I'm not pushing, baby.
Nick, I need to borrow your car.
Okay, hold on. You're making it sound like I assaulted you or something.
You tried to push my head down.
I made a suggestion.
Oh, yeah, and when I didn't take your suggestion, you did it again.
Come on. I wish women were more sex positive, but we're just not there yet.
What?
Guys have to take the lead.
Ugh.
I mean, come on. How else are guys supposed to get blowjobs?
You lean your head back, arch your crotch in the air, and say, dinner is served.
That's not my joke.
Well,
that's
pretty funny. Idea, you could wait for a girl to want to go down on you.
Come on, that's not happening. Am I right, Party Wolf?
Or how about asking?
Oh, good Lord. No, that sounds like the most embarrassing conversation ever.
Well, then you don't get a blowjob.
Okay, yeah. I mean, as long as no one has to talk about it, I'm fine with that.
Or you could go down on her. Pleasure begets pleasure.
All right, that's enough of that.
That is enough of that. I don't know how I feel about that show.
The show's funny. Listen, the whole thing, as I'm saying, is that that scene at the Seinfeld coffee shop where they're like, what's ahead? You can't push.
Yeah.
I've been waiting for someone to do that my whole life. All you had to do was push. Like, I literally have that as a joke. That is the wording I have is exactly that. I've been looking for a clip of it, but thank God I never put those kind of clips online just because I wasn't proud of that joke. I just thought it was funny.
Okay, but in the joke also, what you're saying is that
I got accused of that move. I got accused. So I was making out with a girl and I had my hands on the back of her head, like making out standing up. And she was like, wait a minute, are you trying to push my head to go down on you? And I was like, is that a move? That's a thing I
could
have done.
Can I do that?
Good God, I didn't even know that was a thing.
It's not a thing, guys. Don't do it. Listen, you Weinsteins. This goes out to all the Weinsteins, all the Spaceys, all the Hoffmans, and all the Afflecks out there. Stop pushing head. Don't be a jerk. Jeez, what's wrong with you guys? Seriously,
yeah,
though. When did that become... When did all this be... I guess... I don't know. I guess this behavior's never been okay. These guys know it. They got no excuse. I hope every single guy who's been creepy to a person needs to be called.
Clean it up, creeps.
Yeah, same with creepy ladies.
All right, thank you guys for listening today to the Hollywood Bash Session Moot Points podcast.
Yeah, we're back,
we
baby.
Out some creeps. Came out strong.
We're back, baby. We'll have some more podcasts coming up.
I swear to God, I'm going to get them up at least twice a week, whether or not Pat's here or not.
I got to go back to LA and not book stuff.
I have guests. Pat's going to have to go out and take
I got this great short that I'm shooting with this guy named Harvey Weinstein. This Kevin Spacey cast me in this naked man.
I feel like I feel like we walked this tightrope of being pretty appropriate this whole podcast. And look what you had to do right at the end. Your Weinstein short movie joke.
Yeah.
All right, follow us on Twitter at Moote Points and at Pat Moote. Love you guys. See you again. Well, hopefully Monday.
Yeah.
I'll get one out of this weekend, I promise you.
Yeah. Listen. Speak up. Speak out. These guys suck. Don't cut my mic. Don't cut my mic. Everybody stop grabbing each other. So keep your hands to yourself, goddammit. I'm sick of this. Groping. Why is that even a word? We shouldn't even have a word.
Yeah, groping is gross. All right, see you guys later. supposed to stop talking as the music fades out, Pat.
We need to come up with a word for groping. That's a sad society.
Johnny got a toy golf set when he was 3, and from that day on, he was hooked. All he wanted to do was golf, golf, golf. He'd be on the links before school, after school. All he ever wanted was to go pro. And then, one day, when he was holding his grandson and thinking about his 12 handicap, Johnny realized it just might not happen for him. But you know what did happen for him? He switched to Geico and saved a bunch of money on car insurance. So that was good, and so was hanging out with his grandson.